Come on, put some swag to it. Hey. Here we go, walk. Y'all sound so good. Listen. I see visions. Yeah, they blow my mind. I keep on dreaming. They will manifest in time. So I keep waiting. With expectancy, gotta change my language. Cause out of the heart, the mouth speaks. Even though it's hard for you to see it, yeah, it's the only way that you can believe it. Yeah, yeah. Even though it's hard for you to see it, yeah. Oh,
verse two, listen.
He specializes, yeah, in the impossible things. It comes by hearing. What word are you listening? He's the author,
yes,
and the finisher of my faith. See, great things happen. Do you believe that? Hey. Oh, if you just believe, walk. Even though it's hard for you to see it, yeah, yeah, it's the only way that you can believe them. Yeah, 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 yeah. Going to the bridge. I declare over your life, yeah, deliverance, protection, and prosperity. I declare healing.
I think you got it now.
Even though it's hard for you to see it, yeah, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, it's the only way that you can lead him. Come on, come on and walk, 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 we'll keep on walking. Yeah, yeah. Whoa, fear and faith can't live together. Woo!
Decision to rejoice and be glad in it. I'm Pastor Les, and of course this is Walking by Faith from Victoria's Word Christian Center Church, our virtual Tuesday faith study. Listen, we're going to wrap up faith versus fear when we come back from praise and worship. Don't you go away.
What? life. First you gotta sing the word, speak the word to life. It's in the book, look, read the verses twice. You can possess the best of the best, and yes, if you confess it, it could be yours unless you don't believe, but we got faith and we speak life. I wish that y'all could see your face, cause I see prosperity, greatness all over you. Just speak it and God will start showing you. Your ministry is built on faith. Your calendar about to be booked for 12 months straight. See, certain levels was unreachable, but if you just speak it, who am I preaching to? I'm not here to rap, I'm just teaching you. The word works, but first you gotta speak it to your life. Every goal is still achievable, so believe it, receive it, release it right now.
One word away,
cause it's only
one word away.
Yeah,
power, life, and death.
Put your hands
what
together.
You say.
Affordable mortgages, acres of landlord, I want all of it.
I speak.
A new job that doubles my salary. I believe God will make it reality.
I speak.
To sow seed and reap the harvest. It's in the word, I'ma bless you regardless.
I speak.
A new car, whatever you send to me. But let the gas prices drop tremendously, Lord.
I speak.
That you bless me abundantly. Give me the strength whenever the enemy comes for me.
And I speak.
I will pass this test. This is God's work at his best.
I speak.
Well, watch the places he's about to take you. It is
one word away.
I said one.
One word away. Power of life and death is what you say.
By faith. I'm Pastor Les, and this is Walking by Faith, our virtual Tuesday faith study. Listen, we have been embroiled in a study of faith versus fear. Yes, you and I are on one side of the pendulum or the other. Faith or fear, they swing like that. We're either walking by faith or we're living and walking in fear. We are commanded not to walk in fear because God has not given us, you and I, the spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind. So you and I walk in faith. Once we accept Jesus as our Savior and we become filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost, you and I now are eligible to walk by faith and not by sight. Listen, we're going to pray, we're going to do a little commercial, then we're going to be into our study of faith versus fear. Father, in Jesus' mighty name, we thank you now, the word of God that will go forth today as we conclude this series on faith versus fear. You have not given us a spirit called fear, but you've given us a spirit called power, love, and a sound mind. Father, we embrace what you've given us, and we reject what you did not give us. Father, we thank you that we will not allow any foul, unclean spirit to come against the redemptive word of God. We rebuke those spirits in Jesus' name, that whatsoever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatsoever we loose on earth will be loosed in the heaven. Now, Father, we thank you now for every subscriber, every like, every share that we'll receive today. We thank you that our YouTube family is increasing weekly in the name of Jesus. Now, Father, bless the viewers. Bless those that are looking at this broadcast now. Take them out of fear and plant them in the kingdom in faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Amen. Listen, I want you to do three things for me. Number one, I want you to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Victorious Word Christian Center Church. Victorious Word Christian Center Church here on YouTube. Then I want you to like it. I want you to let us know that these lessons are having an impact on your life, the life of your loved ones, your family, your co-workers, your neighbors, your children, your spouses. Let's like it. Let us know that we are being effective in building the kingdom of God. Number three, I want you to share. Share with a friend, share with a neighbor, a co-worker, a relative, a frenemy. Yeah, share it with a frenemy. Person you thought was your friend but backstabbed you and scandalized your name. Look, bless them by sharing a broadcast you think will bless them. So do those three things for me. Subscribe, like, and share. And listen, by all means, if you desire to sow a seed into Victorious Word Christian Center Church, follow the promptings that will come up on the screen. Follow the promptings on the screen. If you have a church home and you have a pastor and a ministry that you are connected with, sow where you go. But if God lays upon your heart just to sow a seed, a gift into this ministry, it certainly would be appreciated by Lady Walker and I. Okay, that's the commercial. Let's look at the scriptures. Faith versus fear. It is an undeniable truth that Satan can do nothing outside of the realm of fear. That is his modus operandi. That is the way he functions. That is his method of getting his message across to the human race. The method and the vehicle of fear. Satan can do nothing outside the realm of fear because there is absolutely, positively, unconditionally nothing positive in Satan at all. He can't bless, he can't heal, he can't prosper you, he cannot encourage you, and he will not help you. So he works in the area of fear. And what he does, he uses the method of circumstantial fear. He causes things around us to collapse, things around us to fail, things around us and situations and people around us to discourage us. That's his method. That's how he operates. So he can't work outside that realm. Now, on the other side, God cannot work or move or do anything apart from faith. Why do you say that, Pastor Les? Because Hebrews, the 11th chapter, will tell us that without faith, it is impossible. Listen to that word. Without faith, it is impossible. I'm going to say it a third time. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. When a man comes to God, when a person comes to God, when we, you and I, come to God, or whoever comes to God, we must believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So God's modus operandi is faith. He moves in faith. He operates in faith. He heals in faith. He prospers in faith. He promotes by faith. He encourages by faith. He teaches us things by faith. It's the way God works. So what is faith? Scripture tells us in Hebrews 11 again, now faith, and we discovered that faith is always now. It's not yesterday. Yesterday is history. It's not tomorrow. Tomorrow is a mystery. Faith is now. Faith is today. Now faith is. Now is reality. I'm living. You're living. We're living in now. We're not living in the past. We shouldn't be living there. Yesterday is gone. We're not living in the future. We may have a vision for the future, but we're not there yet. So the scripture tells us in Psalms 23, give us this day, what? Our daily bread. We should expect God to feed us daily, not only physical food and sustenance, but spiritual food out of His precious holy word. So give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive. Forgive us as we offer and extend the olive branch of forgiveness. Some of our issues are based upon the fact that we have not forgiven those who have hurt us. In order for your faith to be activated properly and to work properly, you and I must forgive. Forgive so that you will be forgiven. If we do not forgive, God will not forgive us. And that's a terrible state to be in, a state of God not forgiving you. So God says, if we confess our faults, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Praise the name of the living God. Let's look at what fear is. Let's look at Mark 4, 37 through 41. This is the story of Jesus commissioning the disciples to go to the other side. This is the story of faith extending an invitation to disciples to go to the other side. We're talking about the Word of God, Jesus, the personification of faith, beckoning and commissioning and announcing, let us go to the other side. Now, if faith tells you in the flesh, come, let us go to the other side, something would have to just ring in my spirit and say, man, I don't know what's going to come. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what's going to come against this. But this has to turn out all right. If the Word of God has said, come, let us go to the other side. Let's read this for a moment. Mark 4:37. Well, let's start at 35. When Jesus calms the raging sea, the storm. As evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, the Word made this announcement to his disciples. Let's cross to the other side of the lake. Let's cross. Not really your concern how we're going to get there, but the Word has told them, let's cross to the other side of the lake. So they took Jesus, they took the Word in the boat and started out, leaving crowds behind, although other boats followed. But soon a fierce storm came up. Isn't that just like circumstances that just come up out of nowhere, just arise in the middle of your situation? In the middle of what seems to be a victory, clear cut, circumstances shift, things change, and all of a sudden you are found in the midst of a raging storm, right in the midst of what you thought was going to work out perfectly in your favor. Soon a fierce storm came up. High waves were breaking into the boat and it began to fill with water. So now not only has the situation become dire, it looks like it will be life-threatening. By all natural accounts, it looks as though the ship is going to sink and the disciples are all going to drown. But let's look at the response of the Word in the midst of a storm, because the Word is rooted and grounded in faith. Let's look at verse 38. Said in 37 that the ship is filling up with water. It looks naturally as though everybody's going to drown. Verse 38 says, Jesus was sleeping at the back of the boat with his head on a cushion. The Word is at peace. The Word is comfortable. In the midst of a raging, fierce storm that comes up out of nowhere, after the Word has proclaimed, let's go over to the other side. The Word is in the back of the ship, sleep, with his head comfortably relaxing on a cushion. Listen, the disciples woke him up. Jesus, get up, get up, get up, get up, Jesus. Teacher, don't you care that we are going to drown? You hear the fear coming out of that statement? Don't you care that we are going to drown? They have already made a predetermination that, look, we go drown. I know the Word said, and we with the Word, we're with the living Word. But look here, man. Circumstances tell us that we are about to drown. Jesus, don't you even care that this ship is going down? You, the captain of the ship, don't you care that your crewmen are going to drown? Verse 39, when Jesus woke up, when the Word woke up, the Word rebuked the wind and said to the waves, silence, be still. In the midst of a tumultuous, seemingly, potentially catastrophic drowning event, the Word wakes up out of a sound sleep in the midst of a storm and tells the wind and the waves, silence, be still. Shut up. Stop that foolishness. My Word has already went out, and my Word will not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which pleases me and prosper in the thing which to I sent it. I sent my Word into this voyage from one side of this lake, the one side of this sea, one side of this body of water to the other. My Word has already gone out. Let us go to the other side. Now, where do you think we go end up? We are going to end up, no matter what comes and what goes, on the other side of this situation. There's glory on the other side of this storm. Rende kondalabasita, feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost here. Jesus woke up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, silent, be still. Suddenly, the wind stopped, and there was a great calm. There was not just a calm. Jesus totally annihilated the wind, the waves, and the potential danger with his words. Told you, words have power. Positive words have power of faith. Negative words have power in increasing fear. The anointing of the Holy Ghost is in the studio. I feel the anointing of God. Whew, thank you. I confess this in your life today, that the storms that are raging in your life, the Word of faith is calming right now. Storms of sickness, storms of debt, storms of depression, storms of anxiety, storms of marital issues, storms of issues with your children are coming to a great calm right now in Jesus' mighty name. Receive by faith. Hallelujah. Suddenly the wind stopped and there was a great calm. And then the word Jesus turns to the disciples and asks them, why are you afraid? Didn't I tell you, didn't I mention, let's go over to the other side? Didn't the word already give you our final destination, our final resting place will be on the other side? What is wrong with y'all? I'm here with you. You think I'm going to let the winds and the wave kill me? You think he can kill me? You think circumstances can kill the word? Circumstances can overpower the word? Circumstances will influence the word? No, the word had already been spoken, but it seems as though, often like we don't listen to what's being said. Or either when we hear it, we forget it when we get in the middle of a tumultuous situation. That's why we need to always put in remembrance what God has said in his word. Jesus asked them a question, why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? You still don't have any faith? I've shown you miracles. You've been with me in the performance of miracles. I've allowed you to have a hand in performing miracles. You've witnessed miracle upon miracle, but still your faith seems to be waning and your fear factor seems to be increasing. Now, verse 41 says, we're in Mark 4 and 41. Now the disciples were absolutely terrified. They terrified of the word. Who is this man? They asked each other. Even the wind and the waves obey him. He's the word. He has authority, preeminence over circumstances in the spiritual and the natural realm. He's the word of God wrapped in flesh. Let's look at 2 Timothy. Yeah, 2 Timothy 1 and 7. Second Timothy 1 and 7. For God hath not given us a spirit of fear and timidity. Not supposed to be timid. God doesn't have any punk preachers, scary cats, afraid, trembling. No, he hasn't given us a spirit of fear and timidity. But he's given us power through his Holy Spirit to counteract fear, power through his spirit to counter the attacks of the enemy. That's why it is incumbent upon us and really our duty every day to put on the whole armor of God. We have to put it on, not just going to miraculously jump on. We can't get up and just jump in it. We have to be deliberate in our clothing ourselves daily in the whole armor of God. You mean, Pastor? I mean, we have to put on the helmet of salvation every day. What does the helmet do, Pastor? It guards our minds from the fiery darts of the enemy, those thoughts that are contradictory to everything God has promised in our life. God says we're healed. The devil will send thoughts of us being sick. God has said we're prosperous. The job will tell you there's going to be layoffs. Those circumstances will cause you to fear. Now I'm going to lose everything because I'm going to get laid off. I'm not going to be eligible for unemployment. I'm not going to be eligible for any assistance. Put on the helmet of salvation to guard your mind. Our minds have to be renewed. We have to purge our minds from all those negative, contrary thoughts through fear. Then we put on the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate guards our internal organs, particularly our heart. The Bible says to guard our heart with all diligence, for out of it flows, out of the heart flows the issues of life. So we put on the breastplate. Have our loins girded about with truth. The loins are the reproductive part of men and women. We should be reproducing truth. We shall know the truth, and the truth shall make us free. It makes you free to know the truth. God desires truth in the inward parts. Then we shod our feet with the preparation of gospel peace sandals. Everywhere our feet tread, we should bring peace. We should bring calm to an awkward situation. When we arrive on the scene, the anointing that is in our life should bring calm to the situation. We're walking around people and come to a situation where people are acting violently, acting in a disruptive manner. We should bring peace to the situation. We should bring calm. Peace, be still. Then we have the sword of the Spirit in our hand, which is the Word of God. The Word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, joint and marrow. The Word of God is a discerner of the thoughts and intent of the heart. We apply the Word of God to everything we do. Then we hold up the shield of faith to quench the fiery darts of the devil. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Strongholds are mental fortresses that have been set up in our mind over years of negative teaching and negative thinking. We have been programmed over years to think negative. That's why we must be born again. Be born again. Then the Holy Spirit of God begins to purge our spirit, soul, our body from things that aren't pleasing to God and are not conducive to the building of His kingdom. Then last but not least, we pray always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. You should be praying in the Holy Ghost every day at some point in your day. Whether it's when you get up, spend 5-10 minutes just praying in your heavenly language. Rande kondalabasi kandididioso. Rendidibikondalababashai. Holy Spirit will give it to you. On your lunch hour, take 5 minutes between taking bites of your sandwich or your chicken or your sub or your pizza or whatever you're eating. Take a few minutes. Just speak to Him in your heavenly language. It confuses the enemy. While you're driving home from work, and you don't have to do it out loud, you can do it in your spirit. You don't have to utter a word. Just speak in your spirit. While you're driving home from work, before you go in your house, just take 2 minutes, speak in your heavenly language. When you hit your house, go in your room, go in your bathroom, speak in your shower, speak in your bed, speak in your rec room. Before you turn your TV on, give God some of His heavenly language. Yeah. Helmet of salvation. Breastplate of righteousness. Loins girded about with truth. Feet shod with the preparation of gospel of peace. Sandals. Holding up the shield of faith. Have the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God in our hand. Praying with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. In your heavenly language. In the Holy Ghost. Binding and loosing according to the Word of God. Whatsoever we bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatsoever we loose on earth is loosed in heaven. What do you mean, Pastor? You have we have the authority to bind Satan's tactics and methods in the earth. What do you mean, Pastor Les? Here's what I mean. Satan, I bind every diabolical spirit of sickness that you are attempting to put on my family through fear. I decree and declare by faith today that we shall not contract COVID-19, coronavirus, or any Delta variant or any other variant by faith in Jesus' name. We loose the spirit of healing. We loose the spirit of restoration. We loose the spirit of being fixed full and whole from the crown of our heads to the sole of our feet. We bind every diabolical symptom of coronavirus now in Jesus' name. So when you do it, you express verbally to God what it is that you desire. You tell him what you want. Call him up. Call him up on this heavenly line. Tell him what you want according to his word. Amen. So faith is developed through meditating and acting on the word of God. Faith without works is dead. Let's look at James. I love the word of God. I love teaching the word of God. I love hearing the word of God. Let's look at James 2 and 17. James 2 and 17. So you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Faith without corresponding action is dead. When you read the Faith Hall of Fame in Hebrews 11, every one of the acts of the old matriarchs and patriarchs in the Faith Hall of Fame had a corresponding action. When God told Abraham to go to a city that he was not aware of, didn't even know where it was, no map, no GPS, no nothing, the Bible says Abraham went. His corresponding action was that he went. James 2:17. So you see, faith by itself isn't enough unless it produces good deeds. It is dead and useless. Verse 18. Now some may argue, some people have faith, others have good deeds. But I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? How can you tell me you got faith? You don't even go to church. As a matter of fact, you try not to even drive past the church. As a matter of fact, you don't even look in the direction of the church when you drive past. But you have all this gargantuan faith in every situation. No, you're just doing a whole lot of talking, flapping your gums. That's not faith. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. The more faith you hear, the more faith you get, and the more stuff you can go through. The less faith, the less word you hear, the less faith you have, and the quicker you give up, give out, give in the midst of any negative situation, large or small. So everything that comes knocks you off your proverbial square. James says, I will show you my faith with my good deeds. You say you have faith, for you believe that there's only one God. Here's the problem with that. Good for you. Even demons believe this, and they tremble in terror. How foolish a comment this is. Can't you see that faith without good deeds is useless? No, my brother, my sister, my sons and daughters in the kingdom faith, something must accompany your declaration of faith. Faith has things of action attached to them. Our walk is not a walk of works, but faith dictates and suggests that if I proclaim and confess to have faith, there are some things that I'm going to do that are going to correspond with my acknowledgement of my having faith. Hallelujah. Listen, got time for one more scripture, and then we're going to conclude this. Let's see. Let's look at, let me find a good one. Let's look at Revelations. Yeah, let's go to the end book. Let's look at Revelations 1 and 17. See what this says. Revelations 1 and 17. Hallelujah. Revelations 1 and 17. Here's our confidence. It's in the end. It's in Revelations. Genesis was the beginning. Revelation is the end. The revelation of John on the Isle of Patmos, and God was giving him this magnanimous revelation of eschatological inference, because this is the end. This is how everything culminates. Let's look at what John says about our faith. Revelations 1:17. But when I saw him, I fell at his feet as if I were dead. But he laid his right hand on me and said, "Don't be afraid." Isn't it wonderful how faith always comforts and drives out fear in its first declaration? Fear not. Be not afraid. Jesus would say, "It is I." The Spirit of God can be differentiated from the spirit of fear and Satan, because the Spirit of God always puts us at ease and at comfort. Don't be afraid. I am the first and I am the last. I am the living one. I died, but look, I'm alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and the grave. Jesus holds the keys to death and the grave. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin. So you remove the sin, there's no sting or fear of death for the believer. None whatsoever. The believer doesn't fear death. For to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I live, when I live, while I'm living for him, I'm living with him. When I die, when I cease to exist in this natural realm, this natural dispensation, I'm going to him to live forever. So I'm just simply transferring from that which is temporal to that which is eternal. I have the keys. I have the keys to death and the grave. No need to fear, because God has not given us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and sound mind. I want to give you a couple of acronyms as we end. What does fear mean? Fear means this. F, fear, A, ain't, I, N, T, this, H, house. Faith. Fear ain't in this house. What is fear? Fear is false evidence appearing real. False evidence appearing real. Satan cannot tell the truth. He's a liar and the father of all liars. He was a liar from the beginning. And he will be eternally a liar until he is cast into the lake of fire, which God never created for us. Listen, stop walking in fear today, because God didn't give you that spirit. But you won't know that until you become born again, study the Word of God, study the Word of faith, be in a place that's able to teach you the Word of faith, and so you can meditate on the Word of faith and you can exercise your faith. Listen, somebody embraced this message today. and I'm happy about it. You're not saved today. Receive Jesus as your personal Savior. It's real simple. It's real easy. It's not complicated at all. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. With the heart man believes, and with the mouth confession is made to salvation. Listen, you may be a backslider today. It's time for you to come back home like the prodigal son did. Heaven rejoices at the return of a backslider and the salvation of one sinner. Listen, you didn't know the truth before you looked at this broadcast. Now you know the truth, and you have an opportunity to be free. You may not be connected to a faith-building, family-oriented, loving ministry like Victorious Word. You have a time and an opportunity now to become connected to a wonderful ministry. Lady Walker and I would love to have you become a part of the Victorious Word Christian Center family. Real simple. Just email us at walkinvictory@sbcglobal.net. walkinvictory@sbcglobal.net. We'd love to have you. Listen, we're going to pray today for salvation. We're going to pray for the backslider. We're going to pray that you come to the knowledge of truth. We're going to pray that you become connected, even to Victorious Word. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you now for the salvation of even one sinner today, that one person has decided to make Jesus their Lord and Savior, confessing with their mouth, believing in their heart that God raised his son Jesus from the dead, and that he's seated alive right now at the right hand of God the Father in heaven, making intercession for the saints. Father, we thank you today. We thank you today that many backsliders have came back to you today, as the prodigal sons did. We thank you now for their return, and we thank you that they get back in line, but they don't have to get back at the end of the line. We thank you for that now, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you now that somebody has embraced truth today, and they're on a new path of life. We thank you now that someone is connecting with Victorious Word right now, in the name of Jesus. Let's contact us at walkinvictory@sbcglobal.net. walkinvictory@sbcglobal.net. Love to have you. Listen, I'm out of time, but I'm not out of order. And as I always tell you, wherever you go, whatever you do, whoever you meet, tell somebody, tell anybody, tell everybody, wherever you go, tell everybody that Pastor Les told you personally to walk by faith. Walk by faith. Walk by faith and not by sight. I'll see you next time.